everybody. This is Dolores Cannon again with the Metaphysical Hour. And I'm live again tonight. Next week, I'll have to have archives because I'm going to have my hypnosis class in Daytona Beach, Florida. So I'll be down there next Friday. But then I'll be here again for most of October. So at least we never know when I've gone on these long trips is when we have to pull from the archives. But tonight it's live. And last time I was on, last week, I forgot to give out the toll-free number. We do have a toll-free number if anyone wants to call in and ask questions. And we try to take as many of them as we can. But people in the past have told me they'd rather not call in. They'd rather just listen. So let's just see what happens. But here's the toll-free number if anybody does want to call in and talk tonight. Because I've got a subject I'm going to go into, and we'll just see what happens. Okay, the toll-free number is, this is in the States, is 877-876-5227. 877-876-5227. And I got a lot of emails that said they were trying to get on with the questions when I was on the coast-to-coast, but, you know, they only had a certain length of time that they could take them, and so a lot of them didn't make it on the air. So we could see if some of you were one of those people, maybe you can get in tonight then. Okay. But, you know, it's really strange right now. You know, we have this Hurricane Ike is coming in to Texas, and there's all kinds of rumors going on here. Shows you the power of rumors. We're in Arkansas, which is just above Texas, and we know we're probably going to get hit by some of the outer bands or maybe even the remnants of Ike when it comes ashore. They said it's going to come to shore tonight down in Texas, and it's going to be a monster storm. They're evacuating people out of there, and then it'll be moving up here. But when I got back to my office tonight, I had a client earlier. And the rumor they said was going around was that everybody should fill up on their gas because by tomorrow, gas would be up a whole dollar a gallon more, up to $4.50 a gallon. And I said, that's preposterous. That's ridiculous. But that was a rumor that was going around. Now, I don't know if it's true or not. I guess they're figuring that because of the stuff in the Gulf and the oil production will probably be disrupted. But I sure can't see it jumping up that high. But you remember back right after 9/11, and I forgot about it yesterday, was the anniversary of 9/11. Back when that happened in our little town, the gas prices jumped up because they were expecting things were going to happen. But at that time, there was a lot of angry people, and the gas stations said they'd never do that again. So I don't know if it's true or not that they're going to go up, but that's what the information was going around all day. And then right before I went on the air, my son-in-law called, and he said he went in town to fill up, and he was going in on a wing and a prayer, or as we always say, I go in on the fumes, because if you're really out of gas. So he went in to fill up, and he said gas station on the edge of town told him they were totally out of gas. Now, I don't know if anything is going to happen, if there's going to be a shortage, if they're going to raise the price of gas, but that shows you the power of rumor. If enough people believe in it, of course they can create something, they can make it happen. So maybe that's all it is. Another day or so, everything might just be back to normal. But I'm not worried about it because I don't have to go anywhere for a few days. I can stay here. We're probably going to get some of the heavy rains. But it's supposed to be moving in tonight up in this area after it goes through Texas. This is one thing in my sessions, you know, I always ask lots and lots of questions. And I try to find out as much as I can. Over the last year, they, and those of you who know my work, you know who they are, the ones that communicate through all the people that I work with and give me information. They said that we were going to have an increase in natural disasters. It was going to continue. And a lot of it was going to have to do with water. Well, we've certainly had the floods here in our area. And we had this last week, we had 4 days of rain left over from Gustav. But they said it was going to be a lot dealing with water, and there was going to be a lot more severe hurricanes and a lot of disasters just happening everywhere. They said, if you can imagine Katrina happening in several cities all at the same time. Well, we're sure almost getting to that point with these three hurricanes right in a row and each one getting more and more powerful. This is living up exactly to what they were predicting and they were telling me was going to happen, that the natural disasters are going to continue to get worse as the Earth is moving into another vibration, and there's a lot of things happening to the Earth itself. And, you know, I've told you before, you got to remember the Earth is a living being. It really is. It's just like we are living beings. Everything is alive. Everything has consciousness. Everything. Even down to something that is made and created has consciousness. We give it a little bit of our consciousness if we make a table, if we make anything, a car. And I know a lot of people really believe their cars are alive and have personalities. I always used to give my car a name and talk to it to behave itself the way we were out driving somewhere. But everything does have a consciousness. Everything is alive. And this is one thing they've always wanted me to emphasize. If people realize that, they would have a lot different attitude toward things. The things around them, the environment, the ecology, if they knew everything had a personality, had a consciousness, and was alive. So I've been told many, many times that the Earth is a living being. It's allowing us to live on it, and it will continue to do so as long as we don't abuse it too much. And that's what's happening now. They said we are abusing nature, we are abusing the Earth, we are taking too much away from it. And there's an Indian saying, the Earth is like a restless old woman who twists and turns, but it's also like a dog with fleas. If a dog is irritated enough with the fleas, it's going to shake them off and try to get rid of them. So that's what they've told me. If you can compare the Earth to a living being, and we are the fleas on the Earth that are irritating it and causing a lot of problems to it, it's going to get rid of us. It's going to shake us off. And that is what the earthquakes are happening, the cleansing with the water. So it'd be wise to think of that. The Earth has a consciousness. It is alive. And that we've got to be very careful. We're going to anger it or irritate it. It's something we could have to put up with the consequences. You know, in Hawaii, on the Big Island, the island of Hawaii, where the volcanoes are, you know, they have the belief in Pele, the goddess of the volcanoes. And it's a very strong belief. And if it's true, they always say, Pele is one goddess you don't want to make angry. Because when she gets angry, she blows her top. Well, it's very real that these different places and things do have personalities. So we don't want to get the Earth angry to the point that it's going to really try to shake us off and get rid of it. But this is a lot of what's happening right now. Now, last week I was talking about dimensions. I wanted people to understand dimensions, so that they would understand this next part. I didn't want to continue last week because it's a little complicated about the Earth shifting into another dimension and changing its frequency. But when you understand, like I explained last week, that the dimensions are all around us and they're not just numbered 1 through 5 or 1 through 11 as the scientists try to limit them. There are countless dimensions, innumerable dimensions, and it is so vast that we can't even comprehend it with our limited minds. But these dimensions, I said last week, we go in and out of these constantly. The Earth is right now moving into another dimension. The Earth itself is changing its vibration and its frequency so that it can move entirely into another dimension. And a lot of this is what's causing the unrestlessness with the Earth itself and nature itself as it adjusts to this, as it shifts. To understand this, I've been told in my work there have been many, many civilizations that have gone down through history that were very highly advanced. They were at the peak, way, way more advanced than Earth will ever be, than the point we're at right now. Atlantis was not the only one. It reached the heights of advancement. But that's the only one you hear about. But there were many, many more before that that went down. But we just don't have any evidence of them. On one show, I got an email. I was talking about Atlantis, and I got an email from an archaeologist. And the woman said, "How dare you go on the air and talk about a civilization that there is not one shred of evidence that it ever existed?" And I kept thinking, lady, you're an archaeologist. Where is your sense of magic? To me, to be an archaeologist would be so wonderful, to be able to explore and look for mysteries. And here is someone who doesn't even have the sense of mystery that there is more out there than we could possibly believe. I emailed her back and I said, you know, throughout history there were many places that were thought were myths and they didn't exist. They were just legends and stories. But they were proven that they really did exist. One was the legend of Troy, that everyone thought it was just a story, a legend. And I believe the man who discovered it had a dream about it, and he was led to the place where they were to dig, and they did find the lost city of Troy. It was real. This has happened time and time again. There were many cities mentioned in the Bible that people thought didn't exist, and they were also discovered through strange circumstances. So who's to say that Atlantis didn't exist? Well, the information I have about Atlantis, I put a lot of it in my Convoluted Universe Book 1. I have a whole section on Earth's mysteries. Anything that's a mystery, I am always curious about, and I want to explore it and know the answer. So I had many, many people who went into past lives where they were living on Atlantis, and I began to put all these pieces together. Atlantis was not just a island or a piece of land out in the middle of the Atlantic. At that time, it was the entire world. And because it was the entire world, there were some parts that were more advanced and other parts that were primitive. Just the way it is today, our world today, we have highly advanced areas and cities, and then we have the jungles and the parts where they are more native and primitive. This is exactly the way it was during the time of Atlantis. So everybody wasn't advanced. But the cities had enormous potential. They had enormous value. And many, many of these, things were done with crystals. The crystals were used to run electricity the way we would do. They had flying cars. They had airplanes that were like flying vehicles. And everything in the house was powered by crystals. They even had whole walls that just lit up by passing your hand over it. The walls were made out of crystals. They had so much that we can't even imagine. And they had developed this to the peak, the absolute peak of perfection. They had perfected the human body to where there was no longer any disease. They did a lot of this with crystals and colors. They worked a great deal with colors and sound. And many of the people I worked with had talked about rooms that were full of color and designs and things on the walls that would move. And these were chambers where they would heal people with color and sound. And it reached the point to where there was no disease. There was no illness. Everybody was healthy all the time. So they were an advanced people who lived a great lifetimes. They lived many hundreds of years. there was nothing that could kill them because they were so perfected, and they could live as long as they wanted. But the civilization of Atlantis lasted for thousands of years. It was not just a short time, much longer than our civilization here. You know, the American civilization has only been around for, what, a couple of hundred years since we had the revolution and those things. So can you imagine the civilization that would have had thousands of years to perfect itself? They could travel to other planets. They had a lot of close contact with beings on other planets. So there was everything that they could do. They had perfected their minds to where they could do absolutely anything. The pyramids and the great wonders of the world were built by the survivors of Atlantis. They remembered how to do it because in Atlantis they were able to levitate stones. They did a lot of this by sound and with their minds, but they would do it sometimes with groups of people, all meditating and focusing. They could lift stones and levitate them and put them into place. They also had the ability with their minds to make stones malleable. This meant they could shape them to where they would fit together any way they wanted. And I've been to Cusco. If any of you have ever been there, it's quite amazing. The stones there are all molded together, rounded shapes, that one fits right into the next one, as though it was carved to do that. It's almost like it was poured into place. And there's no cement used, and you can't even put a credit card in the groove. It's that tight. This is the way they did in Atlantis. They were able to make the stones malleable and make them be able to mold them and fit them all together. And they had this tremendous power they could do with their minds. So after Atlantis went down, they spread all over the world, the survivors did, and they carried this knowledge and ability with them. But Atlantis is not the only civilization that existed down through time. I've had many sessions where people have lived in other civilizations before Atlantis, where they were also very highly advanced. And they used a lot with crystals, and they also did a lot with healing and with their minds. They all would advance to this point where they would have all of these wonderful abilities. They would help each other, and they could do absolutely everything. I think I've gone through in my work about at least three other civilizations before Atlantis. There may have been even more. But every time, every trace of these civilizations were wiped out. Now, sorry to say for you guys out there, but every time a civilization would reach this point of perfection to where they could do absolutely anything with their minds, man would be the ones who would goof it up. It's always the males, I'm sorry to say, was like they wanted more power, they wanted more greed. I think if it would get to the point that if you could do anything with your mind, then maybe it would become boring. After a while, you'd say, well, I've done it all. What else is there to do? So they began to use the power of their mind in a negative way. And when that would happen, more often than not, they would go against the laws of nature. They said when that happened, then the civilization had to be destroyed. If they couldn't make them stop, the civilization had to go down. And it was usually with a catastrophe of some type. And what I've found time and time again, the people with the powers of their mind, it would usually be the males who wanted to have more power and greed. And there were groups of women who were trained in healing and using the minds and using the crystals. They would always try to use the group minds of the female energy to counteract the male destructive energy to keep it from happening. So you always had a battle, I guess you would say here, between the two energy parts. the female was always trying to balance it out and keep the worst from happening. But it seems as though in each case it failed because the male counterpart had gone too far and they couldn't reverse it. And at the point when the civilization is being destroyed, of course they're saying, wait a minute, I didn't mean this to happen. Help me stop it. By that time, it's too late. They wouldn't listen to the warnings that the female energies were trying to tell them. This is going to happen if you keep on. They always said, no, 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 you don't know what you're talking about. But by the time the civilization is getting ready to be destroyed and the energy has gone too far, then it's too late to reverse it. I had one case like that where it was happening. And the male scientists were blasting holes into the ozone layer. And that's what they told me in the sessions. Doesn't this sound familiar? They were blasting into the center of the Earth for power, as they did during the time of Atlantis. They were blasting into the outer space and ended up making holes in the ozone layer. It got to the point that it let the sun in, because the ozone layer is a protection layer. When it let it in, the intensity of the sun was so great that it destroyed everything. It destroyed the whole civilization. It just burned everything. And they said this is one of these cases is what created the Sahara Deserts. That at one time it was a lush place with wonderful, beautiful forests and orchards and vineyards, but now nothing will grow there because everything was burned whenever they blasted the hole through the ozone layer. Now, when this was happening in this regression, I think all of this may be in convoluted too. I'm not sure. I've got so many stories. But when it was happening, the woman who I was regressing was one of the female group. There was nothing they could do. The world was being destroyed, and she was leaving her body, watching what was happening. And she said, we all have to go to sleep for a while. I thought she meant, well, she was going to die and go to the other side. And she said, no, that's not what I mean. I mean the powers are going to have to go to sleep for a while. They've been abused. They've been misused. They're going to be turned off, rather like blowing a fuse, that the human mind couldn't handle it, and they were not going to be allowed to do it again. It would have to all be taken away until the time was right for it to return again. And that's what she meant, that the powers that they had learned to use would have to go to sleep for a while. And, of course, when she came back into the next life, she was just an ordinary Arab in that nomadic situation in that area, starting all over again from scratch. So it was a totally reversal of what she had been before that. So at that time, they were telling me this, that every time this has happened, you have reached the peak of perfection. We had to take it away. And when it was taken away, you had to start all over again. Everything had to be done again, all over again. That's not the best way to do it, to destroy a civilization and have to begin again from scratch, starting everything all over again. That's not the best way to do it. There will always be survivors. There will always be people who are not destroyed, so they can come back and continue the civilization again, but it will always have to begin at the very beginning again. This has happened time and time again. Many times it was not water as what took Atlantis down. Sometimes I've had them see like huge mountains of earth, like huge landslides coming up and just totally burying the whole civilization. It can be many different ways. They said dirt and debris would come in and destroy the entire civilization. This has happened also. So when I answered that letter from the email from the archaeologist who said, there is no proof of any of this, I said, there's not going to be any proof, because some of these civilizations are not only under the water, the ocean, today, some of them are buried under mountains of dirt. How are you ever going to find any trace of these other civilizations? You won't. That doesn't mean they didn't exist. That doesn't mean they aren't there. That doesn't mean there were remnants of them that may surface again at another time. They are still there somewhere. So during the time of Atlantis, the same thing happened again. Every time the powers that be would say, maybe now man will get it. Man will understand they're not doing it right. Maybe they will understand they can use these powers for good and not abuse them. Well, we haven't got it right yet. So at those times, like with Atlantis, it was water. The scientists had got to where they were using the crystal power and focusing it down through the earth. This is what caused the upheavals of the water and everything that happened. But they also said, they told me when we were doing these sessions, there's another thing you need to know. That is that at the time of Atlantis, they abused the forces of nature. They had gotten bored again, so they were interbreeding animals and humans in the laboratory to create servants, just out of curiosity and out of boredom and thinking, oh, this would be interesting, I'll try it. So they were interbreeding animals and humans. This went against the laws of nature. And when that happened, they said then they knew the civilization had to go down. It could not be allowed to continue along this line. They told me, you need to know this information because your own scientists are heading down this road again. And not only with the ozone layer, but also with the interbreeding. Now, some of you may be familiar with the idea that the scientists have taken human genes and put them into pigs. And they've done this so they can use the organs of the pigs to transplant into human bodies. Because the human body will reject a foreign object, something that is from an animal. It will see it as something that's not compatible. But it will not reject it if it has the human genes that make it identifiable by the body. This is their reasoning. So this is what they're doing now. They are doing this to pigs especially to transplant them into humans. And they were well along with this research. And then a scientist came up and said, you know, maybe we better explore this a little more before we actually allow them to transplant these into the body. We don't really know what we're playing around with here. And they said, maybe if you can handle pigs, you can eat the pork, but what will happen if the organ is in the body and the blood is going through the organ and it becomes a part of the body? Maybe it will create a disease or something that we won't know how to handle. If that happens, we don't know what's going to happen to the human race in the future. So they suggested that they wait and do some more experimentation to see if it could be possible, so they didn't want that to happen. So for a while, they stopped their experimentation to study this. Well, the last I've heard is they now are going ahead with it. They don't really know what's going to happen, but they're going to go ahead with it. So this is why they said we needed to have this information, because we're headed down the same path that Atlantis did when it was destroyed, and these were the things that led to its destruction. When you have the legends of the half-man and half-animal that have come down through time to us, these legends were real, and they came from the time of Atlantis when they were actually doing the experimentation. And we take them as legends from Roman times, from Greek times, But I've always thought that every legend may have had a beginning, a trace in the truth. And that's where it, they said it was. It started out as a true thing that was happening in Atlantis. And then it, the memory of it has been kept alive with the legends that have come down to us. So anyway, they've told me they tried this time and time again. All these different civilizations, they want us to succeed. They want us to reach these peaks of perfection. But every time we couldn't handle it, there would always be something in the mind of man that wanted more, and he just couldn't do it. So the civilization had to go down. Well, they told me we are headed in the same direction again. We're headed down that same road again. They don't want it to happen again. They don't want to have to destroy this world and begin all over again. That's what they're afraid might happen. So they came up with a different type of solution rather than have to destroy the world. And it's a little drastic, it's a little hard to understand, a little complicated. They cannot allow us to destroy the world. If it got to that point, then they would have to intervene. They would have to step in. Because if we were to destroy this world, the reverberations would go out through space. It would go out through other dimensions. It would go out through galaxies. It would disrupt too much. So they couldn't be allowed to happen. Also, it could disturb the civilizations in other dimensions that have nothing to do with ours. So we are under the mandate that they will not interfere with another civilization. This is the Star Trek mandate, and it's real. It really is. The law of non-interference. But the only way they could interfere would be if we got to the point that we were going to blow up the world. This is what they were really worried about. And they've been watching us. As you remember, back at the end of the 40s, when we had the first atomic bombs went off, and the atomic experiments, and when the first bombs went off, at the end of the 40s and the beginning of the 50s is when they began to have a new influx of UFO sightings. This was because, on my other shows, you probably heard me talk about, they are responsible for the seeding of the human race. They are responsible for taking care of us since the very beginning of life on Earth. They watch over us, but they cannot interfere. And they said, give this animal on this beautiful planet an animal with intelligence and free will and see what he does with it. They can't interfere with our own free will. But I see them up there shaking their heads saying, oh my gosh, what are they doing now? But they can only interfere if we're going to blow up the world. So they've been watching us to see what's going to happen. So when the first atomic bombs were exploded, the, you want to call them UFOs, ETs, whatever you want to call them, they've been our observers and watchers since the beginning of time. They watch us and take care of us to see what we're up to. So when that happened, it got their attention. And it was like, uh-oh, we better get down there and see what these kids are up to. What are they playing around with now? So they began to come in. We had more and more sightings happening about that time, just to see what in the world we were doing. Now they know, with free will we've been allowed, we have really made a mess out of our world. And you know that. It's a beautiful, wonderful planet, but we keep making mistakes and we make a big mess out of things. And they said, we can't even solve our own problems in our own life, our own karma, our own things that are going on in our own life. We can't even solve that. We can't solve the problems of our world. So what are we going to do if we're messing around with atomic power, and we can't even handle our own affairs? They said we could end up inadvertently destroying the world. It could not be allowed to happen. So they were going to have to come up with a solution to keep this from happening, because they said every time we have done something like this out of stupidity, we have to begin again. They don't want us to start all over again. So they came up with the idea, why don't we move the entire Earth into another dimension, another frequency? Change the vibration and the frequencies of this world and move it into another dimension. Why don't we do something like that? And the idea is to have two Earths. You have the new Earth and you have the old Earth as they separate. And the old one will remain here with all the problems, all of the things that are going on, all of the disasters, and the new Earth will change vibration and frequency and move into the other dimension. And you know, I said last week too that these other dimensions are moving, are vibrating at different frequencies, and that's why they're invisible to us. We can't see them if we're not in that frequency. So whenever the Earth does move into this new dimension, other frequency, we won't be able to see it because it's going to be vibrating at a different frequency. But this is in the Bible, in the book of Revelations, where it talks about the new heaven and the new earth. They're speaking about the exact same thing that I've been getting all this information about. I've written quite a bit about it in Convoluted Universe Book 2 and Book 3. There's a lot of information about the new earth. And it is in the book of Revelations. The only thing is, when St. John had that vision on the Isle of Patmos, he didn't realize it was not going to happen for thousands of years after that time. And he tried to describe it with symbolism in the book of Revelation, so he couldn't quite understand what was happening. We still don't really have all the answers. I've asked them so many questions about this, and they said, we can't give you all of the answers because we don't really know what's going to happen. This has never happened before in the history of man. We don't know what's going to happen. We don't have the answers ourselves. But it's the greatest show on earth. All of the beings from all of the other galaxies and all the other worlds are watching, because it has never happened before in the history of a universe that an entire planet will shift and move into another dimension. That's why everyone is watching to see what is going to happen, what is going to be about. Now, as it begins, it's been going on since about 2003. As he said, it was actually happening before that, but it was, the effects were so subtle that we really didn't know, wouldn't feel them. But then began in earnest about the year 2003, and it's increasing more dramatically all the time as we go into the year 2012. It's all happening very slow and very subtle until now it's beginning to speed up. Now, these vibrations and frequencies are changing, and we can feel it on our own bodies. But the entire world, you know, you can tell yourself time is speeding up. Time is changing. Time is speeding up, it's getting shorter. We can tell it in a lot of different ways. And we can feel it in our own bodies that something is going on, something different is happening to us as we go through this. Because as the world shifts into another dimension, another frequency, and the new earth is going to be beautiful, it's going to be wonderful. The things they have described there, utter beauty, utter everything good, no illness. You can live as long as you want. It is just truly like the paradise that's described in the Bible. This is going to be something so tremendous as it shifts into the new paradigm, the new dimension. But as it happens, if we want to go with it, our bodies have to change in frequency and vibration also to match that. And they told me it can't happen suddenly. because the human body wouldn't be able to stand change in vibration that quickly. It would destroy the human body. So it has to be done gradually and slowly. And so since 2003, our bodies have been changing. At first, it was slow, but now we're beginning to feel it more and more. Now, people are having effects on the body because as you shift, you'll feel it for a few days or so. Then it will stop, calm down for maybe a few months, and then start in again. It has to give you time to adjust as the body goes to the new frequency. As I said, it couldn't happen all at one time. So as it moves, you're feeling it in your body. And I've had many, many people tell me some of the main symptoms they have. One is heart palpitations, increased heart rate, what's called AFib, are the rather like panic attacks where the body, the heart will be beating too fast. Another symptom is high blood pressure. And then you can also have symptoms of depression, joint aches and pains, muscle aches and pains. A lot of this is rather nondescript. It's kind of vague. But people will go through this for maybe a few days or so. They just know something isn't quite right. So they go to the doctors. The doctors can't find anything wrong with them. Of course, being a doctor, they're going to have to give them a pill or something. But actually, they keep going back to the doctors, and they can't find anything wrong. Then they'll straighten out, and they'll feel okay for a while. Then it will start in again. Same kind of vibrations, and we're affecting the body again. And this is going on now. They say the older you are, the more you're going to feel it. That there's something not quite right. The body is just doesn't feel right with the heart and then the blood pressure and the depression and the joint aches and pains. There's some other symptoms too, but they're so vague that the doctors can't do anything about it because they don't know what it is. But it's enough to make the person uncomfortable when they're going through it. And this will continue until we are all adapted. It's the same thing that I've spoken of before, is when you die and go to the other side, you go to many different places. You go to the place that your frequency and vibration will resonate with and will be vibrating with. That is the part you will go on the other side. You can't go anywhere that your frequency and vibration doesn't vibrate to. So when you actually go through the shift, your body has to be resonating at the same frequency as the earth is as it moves. This is what's happening to our bodies now. And I did the show last week on the Coast to Coast. I mentioned part of this. And I got lots of emails telling me that people were experiencing these same things, same feelings, and going to the doctor and they couldn't find anything wrong with them. So it is happening to a lot of people out there. It's not imaginary. And I know they're not imagining this. It is just something unusual that they don't know, can't quite put a finger on it. The DNA is being changed, too, to help us adapt to all of this. I was told that the doctors are using old information that they were taught. But it's not useful anymore because every day the cells are receiving new information. As the DNA is changing, our bodies are changing, the frequency of the vibration, the cells are receiving new information constantly. So everything is in a state of flux, it's in a state of change right now. So they said, as this happens, it won't be like all of a sudden you get up one morning and suddenly you're in a different place and everything looks different. There is separation between the old earth and the new earth, and it gets a little complicated. You will just gradually begin to know something is different, something is better, Something is happening here, but you can't quite put your finger on it, but it is getting better. But they also said, watch your diets. Your diets will be changing. They've told me many times, the best food we can eat is live foods. By live foods, they mean fresh fruits and vegetables. They said, this is the best thing that you can eat. And to stay away from heavy foods, because in order to make the shift, the body has to become lighter. And this means you have to do away with heavy meats. The vegetarians, the ones that I go to the ashrams and speak there, they're all on the right track. It's about getting the body lighter. And they said, eventually, we're going to be going to all the liquid diets. And I had a lot of emails after the Coast to Coast show where I mentioned that. People said they didn't know why, but all of a sudden they had stopped eating heavy meats, and they were switching to protein drinks and liquids. So they're doing it without even realizing why they are doing it, because the body needs it and they can feel it. Now, everyone is not going to go when this shifts. That's the same thing it says in the Bible, too. Everyone can't go. You can't go unless your vibration and frequency is compatible. There are some people, especially those who are deep into negativity, that won't be allowed to go. You can't change your vibration and frequency that quickly. It has to be done gradually. So those that are still into the negativity and they have no interest in this, they have no idea what is happening, their vibration is still very low and very dense. And they told me they will stay with the old earth. So they will stay with what they have created. They will stay with that. The others will move into the new earth. And it's a little hard to explain. Like I said, you won't suddenly just wake up. Like they said, they don't even have the answers. We can't answer all of your questions because nobody knows what's really going to happen. It has never happened before. But I was at one conference that I talked at, and Annie Kirkwood, I mentioned her. If some of you out there remember, Annie Kirkwood is the one who wrote the book Mary's Message to the World, and it was very popular for quite a while, and we were on a lot of conferences together. We were on panels together. We were on one panel with Annie Kirkwood, and she was talking about a vision that she had had, had been shown, about the new earth and the separation of the two earths. In the vision, she was shown the earth out in outer space. Then she showed the earth begin to pull apart and separate the way a cell does. When a cell begins to divide, it begins to pull apart to create two cells. This is what she saw, the earth beginning to pull apart, and then it split into two earths she could see out in space. And on the one earth, she heard them saying, we did it, we did it, we did it. On the other earth, the old earth, she heard them saying, poor thing, she died believing all that. So this is where it gets a little tricky. Each one will not be aware of the others. They will not even be aware that anything has happened. They won't even be aware that there is a separation and that there are other people who have gone on a different direction. And this is where I'm getting tons of email right now about how do you explain this. I really can't. I try the best I can in my books out of the information I've got and all the questions that I ask. I try very hard to try to explain what I can get from this. But it's as though it's actually separating into two separate Earths, the old Earth and the new Earth. Now, when I did this at one conference, I had a man come up to me afterwards, and he told me, he said, I just want you to know that I am a businessman. I'm very serious. I don't have visions. I don't have things happening. But he says, as you were describing this, he said, all of a sudden the auditorium disappeared And I found myself in outer space observing it, and he said, I saw exactly what you were talking about. I saw the two Earths separating and becoming two actual two. And he said, this is not, I'm not this type of person. So he went home, and he, on the computer, he made up a model of what he saw, and he sent that to me. And in the model, he has the one Earth slightly over the old Earth, the one that's the new Earth, superimposed over it at an angle, is glowing. And he said, you can use this picture. He just didn't want us to let anybody know who he was. So I put it in, I think it's in Convoluted Universe Book 2. I have the picture that he saw. This gives you some kind of an idea of what it looks like as it separates and pulls apart. But there are just so many questions with this. I know people are always asking me about the year 2012 because they say that is something to do with this, and it's the year that the Mayan calendar ended. I have had people go back to those time periods, and they were there during the Mayan times, and, you know, the Mayans disappeared. There were also Indian tribes like the Anunnaki who also disappeared, and no one knew what happened to them. I had people go back to lives when they were there, and they explained to me what happened at that time. They said the Mayans and these Indian tribes had evolved to the point that they were so advanced, they didn't want to be on Earth anymore, and they were able to change their vibrations and frequencies and shift as a civilization into this other dimension. So they moved en masse to the other dimension. And what I was said was that the Mayans in particular were able to see the future. And they could see into the far future there would come a time when an even greater event would occur than them moving their civilization into another dimension. They would see a time when the entire Earth would move with all the people on it into another dimension. That is why they stopped our calendars at 2012, because they could see this would be about the time this momentous event was going to occur. And what I've been told, that does not mean the end of civilization, it does not mean the end of the world, it means the end of civilization as we know it, because at that point we will have, they said it would be the culmination, the vibrations gradually increasing, becoming more recognizable as everything happens, and the two begin to separate. By the year 2012, it will be very obvious what is happening. It is not the end of the cycle, it's the culmination of it, and it will continue on until the two settle down. In the beginning, when you first cross over, you will have a human body like you have now, a physical body. But then, as you're there for I don't know how long it will be, you will gradually turn into energy bodies. And I've spoken to many people in past lives who are energy bodies. They've already evolved to that point. So we will, in time, reach the same point that they are now. Now I know there's tons of questions dealing with all of this. And I've done the best I can in my two books, Convoluted Universe Book 2 and Book 3, to cover the information I've been given. There are still lots and lots of questions, but a lot of the information will be in there. Now, before I go sign off, I know there's lots of questions out there I haven't answered. Before I sign off, I do want to tell people next weekend, next Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, I will be in Daytona Beach, Florida, giving one of my hypnosis classes there. It's going to be at the airport, near the airport there. If you can call our office, you can find out about it. There are still some openings if someone wants to take the class. But it's next Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. So if you want to call the office to find out about my classes, about my travel schedules, my speaking engagements, and about sessions, although we are really booked ahead on sessions, you want to find out about any of these things, about the books, whatever, you can check on my website, www.OzarkMT.com. Or if you're overseas, it's OzarkMT.com. Or you can call our 800 number to find out more information. The number is 1-800-935-0045. 1-800-935-0045. Okay, I hope I've answered some of the questions. I know I've left you with a lot more in your mind. But that's all for tonight anyway. So good night, everybody.
If you enjoyed the show, check out more of our other videos and be sure to subscribe and click the like button. Thank you for listening to the Metaphysical Hour with Dolores Cannon.